Good morning, church. It's good to see you all this morning. You can go ahead and open up your Bibles to John chapter 3. That's where we're going to be in just a minute. John chapter 3. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about Jesus and the greatness of Jesus, the authority of Jesus, and looking in Mark chapter 1 and 2 about some different things that Jesus has authority over and what makes him so great and so worthy of being followed. And that kind of naturally led in my mind to start thinking about a phrase that shows up in John chapter 3, where I think John the Baptist really kind of said it all in John 3 and verse 30 when he says, "He," talking about Jesus, "must increase, but I must decrease." And I want to talk about that this morning in relation to the authority of Jesus and who Jesus is and that phrase and the section where that phrase is found in. And discuss kind of in three different directions what that means in the relationship of John and Jesus, how their relationship kind of operated, and then what we can learn from that in our relationship with Jesus as well. So I just want to start out by reading in John 3, starting in verse 22. John 3 and verse 22 says, "After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, and he remained there with them and was baptizing. John was also baptizing at the Anon near Salim, because water was plentiful there, and people were coming and being baptized, for John had not yet been put in prison. Now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification. And they came to John and said to him, 'Rabbi, he who is with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going to him.' And John answered, 'A person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. And one who has a bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom, who stands and hears him, rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all, and he who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. And whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. And whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him." This morning, what I want to do is just really quickly look at this section and point out what I think are some important things about these verses here, and what we can see in John's relationship with Jesus and how that should translate into how we have a relationship with Jesus as well. And so focusing on that one phrase where John says in verse 30, "He," Jesus, "must increase, but I must decrease." I want to just notice throughout scripture that what John said there happened. Jesus did increase. In a lot of various different ways. We see it here just in this section that we read, where John's disciples are realizing in verse 25 and following that Jesus, the one whom you talked about, who you bore witness about, he's baptizing people. And we see that Jesus is really booming in popularity and really kind of overshadowing John so much to the point that in chapter 4 and verse 1, what we didn't read, it says, "Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John." He's growing far beyond John had grown. And that's really impressive whenever you look and see just how big John the Baptist was and how influential he was. In Mark chapter 1, it says all of Judea and Jerusalem was coming out to John. John's out in the wilderness and he's preaching repentance and baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and crowds of people are coming out to him. And he's not doing anything miraculous while he's out there. He doesn't perform any miracles. He's just teaching. Yet he has so much influence and so much authority that's given to him, and people are coming and respecting and listening to him to where he has his own following. You also see later on in Jesus's life, whenever Jesus is teaching with the Pharisees, and the Pharisees are challenging him, and the scribes show up and challenge him, and the Sadducees and various groups, and they're asking Jesus all these questions and trying to trip him up and catch him in some mistake. And Jesus says, "Well, I'll ask you a question first, and then I'll answer your question. John's baptism, when John was baptizing, was that from heaven or was it from man?" And the Pharisees talk amongst themselves and they say, "Well, if we say it was from heaven, then he'll say, why didn't you believe him? And if we say it's from man, that he wasn't sent from God, then we're afraid of the people because they believe John's a prophet. So they're not willing to challenge John the Baptist in front of the crowds of people. That shows how influential John was in the area of Palestine in the first century. Yet, Jesus is bigger than that and greater than that and increased far beyond all of that. And you see that here in chapter 3, but if you go back to chapter 1, in John chapter 1, you see more of John's perspective on how much he really believes the fact that Jesus needed to increase more than he did, and he needed to decrease. In John chapter 1 and verse 35, this is the second time that's recorded in John that Jesus points out that, or that John points out that Jesus is the Lamb of God. And so in verse 35, he says, "The next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by. And he said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God.' And the two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus." Jesus' popularity is growing so much, and John is so willing for that to happen that he's willing to step out of the way so much to the point that he's directing his followers to say, "Quit following me, follow Jesus now. He's the more important one. He's the Lamb of God. He's the one that I've been sent to prepare the way for this whole time." And so Andrew is one of those disciples we find out. He goes and follows Jesus, and then he tells Peter, his brother, that we found the Messiah, and Peter comes and now is following Jesus, and his discipleship is growing more and more and more throughout his ministry, gaining more and more popularity. And all throughout that, you really see that John was 100% on board with every step of the way, that Jesus was going to get bigger and bigger, and he was going to get lesser and lesser as Jesus's ministry began to grow. And that all makes perfect sense whenever you look in the scriptures and you see what John's whole purpose was even before he was born. In Luke chapter 1, whenever the angel comes to Zechariah and tells Zechariah that he's going to have a son and that Elizabeth is going to have that son in their old age, and he tells them that he's going to be a fulfillment of the prophecy, that he'll come and prepare the way of the Lord, make the people ready, prepare for the Lord, a people that are ready for him, and that kind of thing. And so throughout John's life, he's willing and ready to prepare the way for Jesus and step out of the way for Jesus when he finally comes onto the scene. Now, that's all really incredible and really interesting to see in John's perspective and his awareness of what's going on there. But even more, I think, incredible to see whenever you look later on in Jesus's life when he starts talking about John. In Luke chapter 7, in verse 28, Jesus is talking about John. And he says in verse 28, "I tell you, among those born of woman, there is none greater than John." And then he mentions, "Yet those who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." You think about how big John was just for the people in Palestine. And then this statement that Jesus makes about John, that of those born of woman, there's none greater than John because of the role with which that he had. But relatively speaking, there's not very much information about the life of John recorded in the Bible, at least in comparison to what's recorded about Jesus. John gets like maybe 5 chapters collectively in the New Testament, and Jesus has like all of the rest of the Gospels about his life. And yet, if Jesus says there's none born of woman greater than John, how much greater does that make Jesus in that situation? If so much more time has been focused on Jesus and his life and what he came to accomplish and his purpose, if John is that great, Jesus must be so much greater than what John was. And in spite of the greatness of John, his life, after he fulfilled prophecy and after he prepared the way for the Lord and established this big discipleship and directed them to Jesus, his life really ends rather tragically, recorded in the scriptures. In Mark chapter 6, Mark records the death of John, where he's arrested and thrown in prison. And there's the story of King Herod and Herodias and that adulterous relationship that they find themselves in. And John tells them that it's not lawful for them to be in that relationship. And really, John ends up dying as a result of an adulterous woman's rage and requesting that he's going to be, you know, beheaded so that she doesn't have to listen to him anymore, I guess. And that's really a tragic way for John to die. And in the Gospels, we have in one Gospel recorded the death of John, but nowhere in the Gospels does it talk about the resurrection of John coming back to life. In all 4 Gospels, we have recorded the death of Jesus, and how he died, and how he was mistreated, and how he suffered. And in all 4 of the Gospels, you see how Jesus conquers death and is resurrected and brought back. Another way that Jesus overshadows John and becomes greater and increases more than John does. And then you also see in John chapter 3, just the growing trend of Jesus's discipleship. We talked about that, but I want to mention in Acts, I said John 3, but turn over to the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 1, Jesus has died, he was resurrected, and he's appeared to his disciples again. And he gives them the instruction to go and wait in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes, and then you'll know what you need to do until you receive that power from on high. And then they get the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2, and they start speaking in tongues on the day of Pentecost, and they preach Jesus, the first gospel sermon that's recorded. And 3,000 souls are added to the Lord's church. And you really get the sense in the book of Acts that when Jesus returns back into heaven, that's just kind of the beginning of Jesus's discipleship increasing and his popularity and fame increasing, just at the beginning of Acts. And you look through, there are different phrases that you see throughout the book of Acts that really stand out to me that I think emphasize this point of Jesus continuing to increase. In Acts chapter 6, I want to just read, I think, four of these. Acts chapter 6 and verse 7. It says, "And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith." Now, when you see that phrase, this is going to show up a lot in Acts. When you see the phrase, "Now the word of God continued to increase," what do you think that that means? What's the purpose of Luke recording that? It could mean, maybe often I think when we think of the word of God, we think of like the Bible. And so the word of God continued to increase. Before Acts, this was the word of God on this side. But now we're starting to write Matthew and Mark and all the letters, so we're increasing the word of God. I don't think that's what Luke had in mind when he wrote that in Acts chapter 6, that the actual portfolio of God's word increased. I think there's a deeper meaning to what the word of God increasing is happening here in the first century. Let's keep looking at some of these in Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12 and verse 24, it says, "But the word of God increased and multiplied." Again, later on in history, in the church growing, the word of God is increasing and multiplying. In Acts chapter 13, in verse 49, it says, "And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region." Doesn't use the word increase there, but same idea. Word of God is growing, increasing, spreading, gaining more momentum. And then in chapter 19, Acts 19 in verse 20, it says, "So the word of God, the word of the Lord, continued to increase and prevail mightily." Now, those are all really interesting phrases, I think, and interesting choices of words to use describing the word of God. How it increases, it prevails mightily, it spreads. In the end of Acts, it says that it continued to grow unhindered, and no matter what obstacles came in the way, it continued to grow and overcome and things like that. It's almost as if the word of God is being personified, that it has these traits about it, that it's a person growing and increasing in power and gaining more authority, I suppose. And that happens all throughout scripture. There's an interesting thing, and I don't know, maybe I make too big of a point out of this, and you all can talk to me about this later if you'd like, but all throughout the Bible, the word of God seems to have a personality to it. In Genesis chapter 15, we'll turn back here and look really quickly. Genesis chapter 15, whenever God is going to make his covenant with Abraham, he's still known by Abram here in Genesis 15. It says, "After these things," in Genesis 15, 1, "after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, 'Fear not, Abram, I am your shield, your reward shall be very great.'" It seems to me that the point of what that verse says is that the word of the Lord appeared to Abram. He saw it in a vision. That all kind of starts to make sense to me a little bit more when you put together what's happening in Acts, the word of God increasing and Abram seeing the word of the Lord in a vision and different things like that. When you couple that with what the Apostle John says in John chapter 1, you remember what John says in John chapter 1? "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And in verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." So what you see, not even just before John and when John starts directing more attention to Jesus and saying, "He must increase, I must decrease," in John chapter 3, and throughout Jesus's ministry, he's growing and increasing and gaining more momentum and popularity. But then after he leaves and goes back to heaven, he's continuing to increase and grow and conquer and gain more authority and power as things are being subjected under his feet. So in other words, when you look at the word of God growing and increasing, you're also seeing Jesus continuing to grow and increase. So the first thing that I just want to really point out is that what John said happened. He must increase, and Jesus did increase and is continuing to increase. Now that kind of brings me naturally to think, because John so perfectly illustrated how Jesus needs to increase and he needed to decrease in his life, of directing more of the spotlight to Jesus, making Jesus what his life was all about. But what about for me? Does Jesus need to increase in my life and I decrease in my life also? And for all of us, how does Jesus increase in our lives and we decrease? Is that still necessary? I think yes. So I want to look at both sides in opposite order. First, looking at what it means for us to decrease, and then what it means for Jesus to increase and how that happens. So when you think about me decreasing, the key element that's really in that idea of me decreasing, I think, is humility, right? You have to be humble to be willing to decrease. And there are really kind of two different directions that you can look at humility. A lot of times I think we view humility as like a personality trait. Like we often say things like, that person, he or she, is one of the most humble people that I know, right? They're just a humble person. And what we mean by that is like, they're just a really unassuming person, a really quiet kind of person, a gentle person, a kind person. They're not wanting to seek the spotlight. That they're the type of person, you can think about people like this in your life, that long before they start wanting to talk about themselves, they want to ask about you and they want to know how you're doing and things like that. That person that just has that personality of humility. And I think that's important to have that those people that have that personality of selflessness and willingness to kind of redirect attention on someone else and not have the attention on themselves. And that's a good thing. I think that's a biblical thing. And that's, you know, what we need admire and what we appreciate in people. But humility, I think, goes deeper than just a personality trait when you look scripturally. Biblical humility is more than just what your personality is. It's an attitude that you choose to have. Whether you have an affinity for humility or not, humility is still required for God's people. And so as an attitude, the idea of humility really most clearly manifests, I think, in your willingness to sacrifice. You can have a humble personality and be quiet and gentle and kind of unassuming, but still not be humble. And you can still be manipulative, and you can still insist on your own way in a quiet and unassuming kind of way. And we maybe have known people like that in our lives, or maybe have been like people like that in our own lives. One of, I think, the best, most clear pictures of what it means to be humble in the Bible is in Philippians chapter 2. And this is really what it means, I think, to decrease. Look over in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 3. It says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each one of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This idea of humility that's shown here is thinking less about me and more about others. And Paul gives the reason why that's so important to do that, because that's what our Lord did. That's how he was humble in what he did, in considering others more significant than themselves and not counting the equality with God a thing to be grasped, and submitting himself for the will of God and sacrificing himself for us by becoming obedient to the point of death. And so if I want to be anything like my Lord, I need to be humble. And in order to glorify my Lord, I need to be humble. And you look at the life of John, how John said he must increase, I must decrease. John was willing to humble himself and take a back seat to Jesus in order that Jesus would increase and be glorified. And for me personally in my life, in a lot of different applications, we don't have time to talk about every single direction this can go in this morning. But in my life, am I willing to take the back seat and let Jesus lead? and take the glory in my life. In my conversations with people, am I willing to do that? In my work choices, am I willing to do that? In my personal, you know, entertainment choices, am I willing to do that? In my devotion and my service for other people, am I willing to do that? To let Jesus have the glory and me step out of the spotlight. That's hard to do that. And I think that's a lifelong process of developing this kind of humility, where we need to constantly be disciplining ourselves and training ourselves to be more comfortable stepping back and letting Jesus increase. And John, I think, shows that really well in his life. But that's really just one side of the coin, right? Us decreasing, us developing humility is just the first part of it. It's not enough for me to just decrease. Jesus also has to increase in my life. And there are four really kind of broad ways that I want to look at how Jesus needs to increase in our life, how he ought to be increasing. And the first way is he needs to increase in my personal devotion to him and in our personal devotion to him, in how I spend my time and how I want to think about and what I want to do. The hope is that my life will become less about me and more about him and what he desires. And that when people start looking at my life, they see Jesus more in how I act and how I treat people and the things that I choose to do and think about and say and all those types of things. You see that, I think, kind of clearly in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 1 says, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Imitate God. Be more like God. When you look at the whole book of Ephesians, in the first few chapters, the first three chapters of Ephesians, Paul spends a long time talking about the love of God and the greatness of God and the greatness of Jesus and what they've accomplished for us and giving us life and reconciling us back to God and Jesus' sacrifice and how the love of Christ is just so much more than you can even possibly fathom. But Paul wished that the recipients of his letter could have fathomed that. And he ends chapter 3 by saying God can do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think. He is so great in what he's done and been gracious to us. And that transitions in chapter 4 to start saying, now you need to start living worthy of that. And you need to be worthy of that. Walk worthy of the calling to which you've been called. And he gets into the end of chapter 4 and chapter 5 and 6 talking about very specifically and practically what that means. How you need to put off your old self and crucify your old self and quit lying, but rather speak the truth. Quit stealing, but rather work with your hands and share with those who are in need. And he talks about our personal relationships, the husband and wife. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. This is right. Honor your father and mother. Fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath. Slaves, servants, obey your masters in everything. Masters, remember that you also have a master, so treat your servants well. And he transitions all of that. When you look at all of those pieces, what you see really kind of culminates in chapter 5 and verse 1. Imitate God. Because what did Jesus do? He submitted himself. He loved. He obeyed his father. He submitted to his master. He treated his servants well. He was the perfect example in all of those different areas of what we need to do. And so if I want Jesus to increase, I need to deny myself, like Jesus says in Luke chapter 9, take up my cross and follow him every single day, and allow him to increase in my life by kind of doing what he wants me to do in my life and what he had the example of doing in his life. I hate to use the cliche, and I'm sad that it is a cliche because I think it really is a biblical idea. But it's the basic idea of what would Jesus want me to do? What would Jesus do in my life, in the decisions that I do? And I know that's a overly used phrase, but that's what the Bible says. Imitate Christ. What would Jesus do? I need to deny what I want to do sometimes and do what Jesus wants to do in order for him to increase and be glorified. That's one way that he increases in our lives, but he also needs to increase, I think, more specifically in the way that I evangelize and how I spread Jesus. You see that happen in the Acts of the Apostles, how the word of God continued to increase and multiply greatly, and Jesus increased in that way. And how did that happen in the book of Acts? It happened from men and women going out and talking about Jesus. That's how Jesus increased in the book of Acts. And that's such a simple concept that I fail in so much in my life, of just going and talking to whoever wants to listen about Jesus. It's so simple. It's so easy. And it should be so easy because of how great Jesus is. Who wouldn't want to hear about Jesus? But so many times I find myself thinking, no, that might be, you know, an inconvenience. That's kind of embarrassing to talk about that. But if I really want to decrease and let Jesus increase in my life, that's going to reflect in how I talk about him with other people and bring other people to him and allow him to continue to grow and increase in that way. A third way that he needs to increase, I think, is in the church, increasing in the church. If we ever get in the mindset or the point of thinking that this is all about us, we're really missing the point. This is all about Jesus. That's why we're here, to glorify him, to remember him like what we do every first day of the week and what he did for us and died and the suffering that he went through on our behalf, and to glorify him and let him grow. And that reflects, I think, in scripture as well. I think we're still in Ephesians. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 12. We'll start in verse 11. Ephesians 1 verse 11 says, "In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who are the first hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory." That phrase shows up twice, at the end of verse 14 and at the end of verse 12. Why did God do what he did for us? That's a deep question, I think, to ask. It's because he loved us, because of his grace, because of his mercy, and all of that plays into it. But hear what Paul says in Ephesians 1. He did what he did for us to the praise of his glory, for him to be glorified. And you see that show up in Ephesians a few different times, of how God's manifold wisdom is proclaimed to the rulers and authorities and the powers in Ephesians chapter 3, that we are kind of the grand masterpiece of God's wisdom and his might and his grace and power. And it's not for us, really. There are blessings that we reap from that, but it's so that God will be glorified. I heard someone once say that if you're not interested in praising God right now, you're not really interested in going to heaven. Because that's really kind of what going to heaven is all about, right? To go and praise God for all eternity, for what he's done for us, and be in the presence of God. It's not about us. And so Jesus needs to increase in the church collectively. And I think that that will manifest in a few different ways of Jesus increasing. One way that that will manifest is like what Jesus said whenever he gave the new commandment to his disciples. And he said, "By this, the world will know that you're my disciples, that you love one another." Jesus increasing among the church will manifest in how we love each other. And that's important, how we love each other and how we treat each other and how we think about each other, allowing Jesus to increase and us decrease in that way. And so race doesn't matter. Ethnicity doesn't matter, economic class doesn't matter, ability doesn't matter, disability doesn't matter, whatever, fill in the blank, it doesn't matter. Like what Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, we're all one in Christ. All of those start to fade away in the glory of Christ, and it doesn't matter anymore because we love each other because we're a part of the same body and have that unity together. And Jesus increases in that way. It also manifests, not just in how we love each other, but how we love the lost. I'm amazed whenever I read through the Gospels and you see how Jesus felt about the lost. It's incredible how compassionate and how willing to sacrifice Jesus was for the lost. And that, when you think about the lost, often we think about just not ourselves, but we're included, I think. We were included in the lost before Jesus saved us. And it reminds me of what Paul says in Romans chapter 5. You think about the love of Christ, the love of God, it was manifest in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's a huge amount of love. He says one would scarcely die for a righteous person, one for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. You think about if you want Jesus to increase in your life, how do you feel about people? Like just people in the world, your neighbors. How do you feel about your neighbors? What do you want for them? Or your coworkers? How do you feel about them? Or your enemies? That's a big one. How do you feel about your enemies? If I want Jesus to increase in my life, I need to feel the way that Jesus feels about people. And not wishing that they should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's a big thing, a big challenge. But something that I need to decrease in and Jesus needs to increase in as well. The last thing that I want to talk about how Jesus increases, and this is maybe kind of a deeper idea, but I think one that's important and interesting to think about, is that Jesus needs to increase always for all eternity, and will increase for all eternity. I don't think that in Revelation, you can turn to Revelation chapter 4 and 5. I don't think that Revelation chapter 4 and 5 are giving an exact picture of exactly what heaven is going to be like for all eternity, but John is invited up into heaven in Revelation 4 to observe some things that are going on, and he records them for us. And the pictures and images that he records for us to see really kind of center and focus on the one who's on the throne and the Lamb. And look at what happens as this scene unfolds. We're not going to read both chapters, but just a few sections here. Look at what happens as the scene unfolds and what the focus is. In Revelation chapter 4 and verse 8, it says, "And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come.'" And down in verse 11, it says, "They continue to sing, 'Worthy are you, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created.'" And in chapter 5, the Lamb comes on the scene and takes the scroll that nobody could open that the one seated on the throne is holding. And he begins to be the focus of praise and adoration. In verse 9, they sang a new song saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open up its seals, for you were slain. And by your blood, you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom of priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." And then in verse 11, you start to see this, I think, kind of juxtaposition where the crowds start to increase in number. But what you really kind of see happening is they're decreasing more and the praise is increasing more. Look at how that happens here. In verse 11, it says, "Then I, John, looked and I heard around the throne the living creatures and the elders and the voice of many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands." That's a lot of angels. Show up in verse 12, and they start saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Then it gets bigger in verse 13. "And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, 'To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever.' And the four living creatures said, 'Amen.' And the elders fell down and worshiped." You see, the glory of Christ, the glory of the Father, glory of God, continuing to increase more and more. As more people are gathered together to honor him and praise him and worship him and sing to him, they are growing in number, increasing, but they're really decreasing compared to the praise that's being offered to God in Christ. And so that phrase that John makes in John chapter 3, I think is so profound to just sit and ponder and think about personally for my life, but also in the grand scheme of eternity. What does that mean? Jesus must increase, yet I must decrease. I think it's something that all of us need to think about in our personal lives and the decisions that we make and want Jesus to increase and us to decrease, and then do things to make that happen in our personal lives and how other people see us in our lives. Because it's not about me, it's about Jesus. And there's another big reason. I want to finish back in John chapter 3 of why this is important. At the end of John chapter 3, in verse 35, it says, "The Father loves the Son, and he has given all things into his hand." Verse 36 says, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him." It's so important for Jesus to increase and for me to decrease in my life because according to John chapter 3, verse 36, there are two different directions that my life could go. Either I could believe in the Son and he increase and I decrease and I get eternal life and I'm blessed for that. Or I increase and Jesus decreases, and I don't obey the Son, and I will not see life, but the wrath of God remains on me. You have the decision of who you want to increase, me or Jesus. And all of us need to make the decision that Jesus would increase and I would decrease. That's the right decision to make. There's a song that we sing sometimes that I don't really like, but I do really like, where it goes kind of through the progression of life. And it starts off in verse 1 saying, all of self and none of thee. And you get to verse 2 and it's like, most of self and some of thee. And then verse 3, some of self and some of thee. And verse 4, okay, less of self and more of thee. And the final verse is all of self, or all of thee and none of self. I keep messing up. You guys know what I'm saying. Jesus gets bigger. Jesus is increasing and I'm decreasing. That's a hard thing to do. It's easy to read and to see and to appreciate, I think, whenever you see Jesus increasing. But it's a challenge to deny ourselves every single day and make Jesus increase more in our lives. But it needs to happen so that he can be glorified and that we'll be blessed and be able to be called God's children. If you need to do that this morning for the first time, deny yourself completely and bury yourself, take up your cross and follow Jesus, you can do that in baptism and allow him to start increasing more in your life and you start decreasing and see the blessings and benefits of that in your life. Or if you need the prayers of the church here and the help, because all of us are working together to glorify Christ and allow him to increase collectively, but we can also help individually in praying for each other and encouraging each other and building each other up in this lifelong process of increasing Jesus and decreasing ourselves. So if you need the help of the church this morning, you can come forward, talk to me about that now while we stand and sing.